Welcome to new Savage's Dev Podcast, Development Podcast, and this time around it's I think part 5 now, I think, of Filecat, and no, it's not really part 5, but it's more a general video about how to release your finished masterwork or masterpiece. In this case, Filecat is already released, but I want to have a new release out there. Yeah, what do I do usually when I before I release or for releasing an application? Of course, I will test it. So, like Filecat, the changes that I did to Filecat, I tested for I think 1 week, 5 days, 1 work week, something like this. I tested it, ran it on multiple devices that I have here, a Gemini PDA, an Xperia 10 Plus device I have running with Surface and the XA2 and the other one, and yeah, test it. It's really important, especially when it comes to file copying processes and so on, and maybe also stuff that you are not really sure how it will work out. And yeah, I tested the hell out of it, I would say it, and it's running. Is it perfect? Maybe not so much. I can show you in the emulator a bit what I mean. So first of all, if I have some files here, have some wallhaven files here, for example, I want to select them. I can select them. You can see it's not perfect yet, as these little dots here are sometimes on top of the detailed information about a file. So this needs perhaps a little bit of fixing here and there. So it's not perfect yet. I'm not quite sure how to fix that, but I can look into it. Just like, for example, it's a quick fix in this case because it's pretty easy. And I think it is in file item delegate, exactly. There we have the delegates, and what we have to do is the file info width needs to have, as you can see here, it's parent width minus the file icon width minus the embedding, blah 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 blah. And what we simply need to do is check. We need a check here for if the mselect is available. If it's available, we have to make the width smaller. And yeah, it's pretty easy. So what I will do here, I'm not sure if this is the right way to do it, but what I will do here is just put in a simple if statement. In this case, I can just say, let's do it correctly, select visible, because we have a visible setting for multi-select here, and if it is visible, so this is how you do a simple if statement. If it's visible, what we want to do is simply, let me copy this first, is simply set here minus m select dot width. Or I can put, oh, maybe let's do it like this. So we have a minus here, and then we are basically having the parent. Let's make a return out of it. Do we need to return it? Okay, don't return it. So at least this is what should come out of it. If the mselect is visible, we will have the width set to parent width minus the file icon width, and then minus all the padding stuff and the mselect width if it's visible. If it isn't visible, we will just simply put the stuff that we had before here in, and not sure if this is readable. Let's make it really readable like this. If then this, and else than this. Okay, now I think it is better understandable. So the width will be set depending on mselect, and yeah, of course, this is something I can fix quite easily. And this is the fine stuff that you need to do before releasing something is trying to make sure that your graphical user interface looks fine. It's not only the logic behind copy, paste and all the stuff I was working on is working and looking fine for me, it's also the eyes. So it needs to look professional, or it needs to not look broken in a way. And this is of course aesthetics, and not all people have this or can see this all the time, so it's important also, and I'm also including myself, not always seeing my mistakes when it comes to design. So what you have to do, or what I'm really doing is in this case, oh, I've started it on my Yola phone instead of the virtual machine. Let's start again. So if you don't see it all the time, it's important that you have some other testers, some other eyes looking at it. And that are the best is if you have a device, you can give it to this person in the hand and they can try to figure out stuff. This is very important sometimes to get the idea if it's working, the design that you are using, the workflow, and also asking if there's something that's not working the way that the user expect this to work. So now let's go here. You can see the widths. Now let's go to select mode, and you can see it works now a dozen times better. It just looks more clean by not having the whole stuff here. Having the whole stuff overlapping each other. So this is very important. Then of course, what's next? You saw that for a second I was hesitating because I wanted not to click on the name, but I wanted to click on here, on these little dots. But I can click on it, nothing will happen for some reason. So this is another thing. It just looks fine, but another little bug that you can avoid by taking a look here. And I remember that I in the switch on clicked, you can see checked, unchecked is in here, but somehow it's not working. And now what I want to do is having here a little debug output that shows if it was clicked or not to see what's going on. So this is a little nitpicking, trying to find out what's working, what's not working, and trying to fix stuff up. And this is really important to do. As you can see here, this with the widths worked fine. So what I can do here right now is also after this is tested, I can commit this. Of course, I forgot already about committing. It's also very important to commit your changes just like this one. So now let's see if this is working. Going to select and then so mselect clicked, you can see mselect clicked is indeed executed when I click on this, but it's not marking those files. So now the question is why. And now what you can see here is that mselect checked is the one that is executed when I do the in the delegate itself, when I click on the file name itself, if I'm in multi-select. So what I have here basically the same as is checked equals unchecked. What I will do is just simply okay, as I know that this is executed, I would just enter this in here and see what will happen then, because maybe it's the checked is not recognized here. And this is what I will do, and rerun it. The other thing is maybe it can just ignore the onclicked together. Let's go into here and see. It has a toggle function, a method to toggle the switch. If the switch is on, the toggling it will return off. Toggling a switch in off position will turn it on. Yeah, or can execute the toggle, a method simply, which would be lot easier here, I think. And the other thing is, do we need to have this onClicked? Do I need? Is this really a function here in the switch? As you can see here in the documentation, I don't see it right now. Oh, wait a second. This is not the right documentation. Let's see right now. This is a import UI components one. This does not look. Looks. It does not look like it's the right documentation. Because we are using the SafeHSS switch. So interesting. Let's see. Yeah, the. Where is it? SafeHSS secrets? No, 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 no. Icon reference? No. The CK user manual? Where are the. Am I blind? I think I'm blind. There's a search. There was also a search somewhere, but. Where's the reference? Here's SafeSilica. And here's the reference. And here we can search for switch. And this is the switch documentation that I want to use from Silica 1. I'm not sure why it's showing me the other one. And there we have a checked, busy, automatic, down, highlighted, and icon. But we don't have a onClicked one. So the question is, do we really need the onClicked one? Could be that we don't need it at all. Let's check in the emulator again and see if this will work out. Nope, it's not working. So what I simply will do is maybe remove this onClicked completely and let the switch be a switch. Let me close all those other ones here. And we'll see if this will work out now. Because maybe it is, I think it should have an automatic function to, when I click on it, to change the checked. And maybe when I have the onClicked in there and changing the checked to another checked and internally is also setting it true, and I'm with the onClicked setting it to false again, might be the explanation why it is not working. So let's see again if this will work out. Yes. Of course, now it is working like expected. So those little things are things that you need to do. So what I will do now is, first of all, let me go back to the original code that we had here. And I will go to this here. You can see my git history of FileCat. What I will do is, of course, check again my diff and then add this fix first, which is simply a fix of fix overlapping file details in multi-select mode. And then the next thing is I will go and do this, save this, and git diff, and there you can see I removed this, and git commit make. Not clicking, maybe tapping. Switch and multi work. So this is also something interesting. I can push this all together, and these are the little fixes that you have to apply to your application and that you will notice when using the application that are a bit annoying sometimes. So I think now I'm pretty much happy, but there are some caveats still. So what I like to do is, because now I reached a point where I would say this is releasable, but there are some things that people need to know which are a bit conf- or could be a bit confusing. in my tests and all the testers that I had that used the application so far did not report any issues when it comes to the multi-select bar and doing what they want to do. But there are some caveats and some issues, just like, for example, let me maybe open up a terminal here, not full screen, and we want to SSH into our system and go here and then use a touch command for our documents. This is annoying. This is an annoying bug if you create new files, especially two or three new files, that it will simply have a problem with refreshing. I could in theory add a manual refresh here, but I don't want to do this. What I simply do is clicking on hiding and then simply disable the hidden files, and this will get rid of it. So if you have the problem, there's a workaround for this. So far no one reported this bug, by the way, interestingly enough. Maybe because it's so obvious, because I'm recording this on the screencast here. So what you will notice is, if I have if I'm in select mode and I want to, let's say those two files I want to cut out, and I want to put them in documents, and then I decide, this file I want to select as well, but this one I want to copy. Now what you see right now, it's obvious, when I go to documents and say paste three files, because we had three files selected, what it will do is paste all three files here, which is cool, but leave all the files here, because the you saw it, the multi-select view, I was overwriting basically the multi-select view stuff. So I was overwriting it, the cut command I was overwriting, because all those were marked. But what if I have those files here that I want to cut, and I go into documents and I have doc2 that I want to copy? Now it's not very obvious that, okay, it's obvious that I choose copy here for doc2 and I choose cut for the other two. But now if I go to, let's create a test directory. If I go here to test directory, I want to paste all the files. What will happen is it will, that's a bit weird, it so it will paste doc1 and doc2. And you can see doc1 and doc2 are still here. So there's some kind of confusion going on. Where's doc3? Doc3 is not in there, I'm not sure why. So there's some kind of confusion going on. But what will happen is the last command, basically, the copy command, will be taken, overrides the whole clipboard with the last command that you pressed, which will be then copy instead of cut. So this is an issue. The question is now what to do, because we only have one clipboard, and this is a basically systematic problem of this only having one clipboard. What you could do, of course, is before putting something into the clipboard, is, or when putting something into the clipboard and pressing a button. No. When putting, this is hard to do, I think. What you have to do is, it's a completely different system, basically, is you select the files and you don't put them automatically into the clipboard. You only put them into the clipboard when the user presses one of those buttons. Then you will iterate to all the marked model items and put them into the clipboard with a specific method like cut or copy, so that the clipboard then later knows when I try to paste stuff that it knows that these two files need to be moved and the other one file or two or three files need to be copied. This is a more of a complex situation going on and complex situation to do this, and this is something that I want to try out and test in one later version, because so far no confusion by all the testers and no confusion by me, by myself. But this is one more complex copy process that on your desktop you don't even do this, because on the desktop you also only have one clipboard. On a normal desktop, Plasma desktop, Windows desktop or macOS desktop, you have one clipboard, and what you do usually is you mark all the files that you want to copy or cut, and then you cut them and then you paste them, but you don't have an intelligent clipboard that is so intelligent that all the stuff that you put into the clipboard, you can put stuff that needs to be cut and stuff that needs to be pasted, and it will distinguish between those two. So this is not something that is common, but this is an idea that could work as well, but I'm not following it right now. I will follow it in the future maybe and explore this. The other thing is, of course, there's an issue as well. When I have, for example, selected three docs, how, and I go back now, how do I get those three docs that I have selected here? Let's select the cut function for those. And now I decide, document two. No, I see I have document two here. I don't need it to be here. How do I get it? Get rid of it. There is no easy way to see the clipboard. What's in the clipboard? The only indication you have is here, and here you can see paste six files right now, which is also an issue that should not happen. Should it? No, it's okay, I think, because I did not paste anything. But you see here now I have six files. So this is the only indicator where I can see what I have in my clipboard. So I also don't have a detection for double entries in the clipboard or something like this, which could happen. So what I can do, of course, to clear the clipboard, to manipulate this, is go into select mode and then press the X here. And what will happen is you can see, oh, it still says six files. It should go away when I click here. It should clear the clipboard. It's not clearing the clipboard. So this might be a thing that I want to do. So, but is it good to do? The other thing is, if I go here, you can see this is still on the clipboard, and you can see I still have six files in the clipboard. So I'm missing some kind of a configuration of the clipboard. Clear everything out of the clipboard. The only thing to clear out after switching or even closing here, after going out of this, is not possible. So I still have the option to paste six files here. So this is a limitation somehow that I'm not able to clear everything out of the clipboard. How to change this? This is not the question. Easiest way would be adding simply a menu entry maybe here, but you can see we have four entries already here. And fifth entry would be maybe a bit overkill. So what do we do with the clipboard thing? How do we indicate that there is something in the clipboard, and that we can, because we have this paste six file stuff, but how can I put something in that tells me I want to now edit the clipboard? I want to remove stuff from the clipboard. So what I currently need to do for removing stuff from the clipboard is going out of here and restart the application. So it does not save the state of what is checked or unchecked in the clipboard, which is bad. So what we have to do in a way is, and this is a bit of complicated and more random stuff here, randomly throwing it in right now, is to have some kind of check, because we have the clipboard here. We can add and remove. What we have to do is a find command. We need a find command to then when we populate our file model, we can find if the path is inside here, and then we can mark stuff. This is, I think, how it should work for a global clipboard. You can see this is getting a little bit complicated here right now. So we need a find function. And yeah, what I will do right now is just simply search for a find function then. Because I think in... Let me go here in my WebCat application. I have a find function for bookmarks, I think. So let me check here. We'll open up in an editor. And this is not here. Remove bookmarks, add bookmarks, contains. We have a contains function. Okay, this is good enough. Let's copy this. And not going here, and we will put it in here, a contains function. Then we put in a URL. This is in this case not site URL but file URL, or we can, for the sake of it, call it path. And as we usually have the whole path and give this as an argument to the whole path, it's not a problem to see if this is in here as a path is in the source one of the URLs here. And yeah, then we return true, and else we just return false. Is this right now? Yeah, that looks right. So we have a contains function now that will check if something is in our clipboard, and then it will return true. Otherwise, it will return false. Yeah. So basically, it will return true. So this, if it finds something, it will return true. And in the for loop, otherwise, and then it will go out of the for loop and will end this function. And so, if it will go through the loop here and it will not return anything, then it will go here and go to false again. So, I don't need something else. So, this is a whole function. I think it's pretty easy understandable. So, we now have a contains function, and what we need to do now is in file item delegate. Check or have this here, the checked command, check the file path if it's inside or not. So what I will do here is simply also have a function. Basically, now I can use the simple if statement, just like what is it called? Clipboard contains. So we have clipboard contains. Then we give it a file path. File label, file icon, file info, file name. Wait a second, is it called, yeah, it's called file path. So we check if it contains it. If this is true, we have a checked true, else it is false. So what this in theory should allow us is at least to have a better understanding. So we don't have a list view yet. This will come in one later version, I think, but now we have a version that I would think, if this is working, we can in a manual way remove stuff from the clipboard without any problems. The other problem is, if I have cut and copy and all this stuff, but I don't want to, I want to clear everything out of the clipboard. How to deal with this? And I will show you a trick here and there that I'd like to build in to some of those applications that might not be very user-friendly on the first glance, but it's a workaround. So let's go here. We select dock 1 and dock 3. We go into cut. We go here. We see it's already here. I want to select dock 2. I want to cut as well. And yeah, now I go back here. Now I can see we have 3 files here. And now let's go into select mode. I go click on something else. And as you can see here, dock 3, dock 1 are selected. And of course also videos is selected now because I selected it right now. What I can do here is just simply take it out of this, click on X. And what you see right now is it says PS3 files. So it's not working for some reason. But at least, and the same goes for if I go here and then go into select mode, you can see that dock 2 is selected. And it's still stating that we have 3 files in the clipboard, which is interesting because there shouldn't be stuff in the clipboard. Another question is, why is it in the clipboard? And unchecked, checked, add. Otherwise, remove file path. Okay, so let's go to our the remove thing, the remove function, and then it's a console log remove from clipboard, and then state the path. Yeah. That should be removed, and then it's running the for loop. What I would simply do is if get I source is path, then remove this. Yeah, that should work. Aha, then remove I. It's calling the remove function. This won't work, of course, because it's in the loop then. List model, what does it have? It has a remove function here. So what we have to do is simply we cannot override this remove function. We'll call it rm path. So I found a simple bug, and then remove I think it is a simple bug. So what I need to do is here also rename it to rm. Could name it differently, but rm is quite short. So let's see if this will work out. Yeah, those videos are getting very, very long. It's because I'm just starting with a plan, roughly what I want to do. Just I want to finish everything and show you how to bump the RPM spec and give out a new version. But in reality, all the little things are keep creeping in that need to be fixing, and I want them to be fixed before I release something. So let's have those two cut. Go here. Select this, cut again, go back. And of course I click double time, but it is working. As you can see here, we have pasted 3 files. Now let's deselect this one, this one. Close. We still have 3 files in here. But clipboard itself says remove dock 1 and dock 3 from clipboard. Let's go to documents. Still showing 3 files. Still showing 3 files. Doesn't make any sense to me as the Let's maybe go to, let's create a folder here. And let's maybe create this folder and try what happens when I paste stuff in here. Ah, nothing will happen. So, you can see it did not paste anything here. So that means the clipboard is indeed empty. But it's showing still paste free files. So we have a problem with our, let's go, let's try something like this. And this I want to cut. And this I want to cut. Let's go to documents, test. Still showing paste free files. And now pasting worked. And it said something about error pasting free files, but it pasted the free files. I think the error was in removing the files. Because that's an issue somehow. So could not remove the files for some reason. Maybe I created them as root. But in general, it worked. As you can see here, all the free files are here. Let's delete this. File deletion succeeded. Okay. Maybe in documents, let's also delete those two files. You can see that when I'm deleting files, I'm so used to just holding and deleting them one by one instead of using the multi-select bar that I forgot to test it out. And yeah, remove this one. Oops. Now we have doc2, doc1 and doc3 here. So we have an issue with the paste not updating itself. So what we have to do is take a look at, first of all, this is now correct, I think. We have this really running. Oops. So the remove function is working. What we still have a problem with is the paste in the open dialog itself. So where do we have it? Here we have the paste. Ah, now we know what the issue is, because we have, it's using the find base name, and then it's just simply using fm source URL, and fm source URL is not set here, it is set somewhere else to the amount of files that we have. So let's go see fm source URL, where do we have it? Where do we set it? I forgot already. It's not set here. It's in the multi-select bar, maybe. Yeah, here we set it to clipboard count and then the files. And of course, this is not updating automatically when clipboard count is updating itself. So what we need to do here is a bit of a different way. What we have to do is just, instead of using this here, setting this here, is we copy this here out of here and into open dialog. In, we set it just simply in our, where is it, paste, exactly here in our paste command. So how do we do this? Let's first add this here. This is what we want to have, clipboard count plus files. And this is what we want to have instead of find base name FM source. So how do we do this? We'll do it like this, because we have the paste, this is good. What we have to do is, so I think we need a free space here. What we want to do is check if the clipboard count is greater than 1. So if clipboard count greater 1, then we want to have in theory it's wrong to have it greater than greater than 1. Yeah, greater than 1 is correct. Then we want to have it like we had it before, just like we want to have maybe we can make it a bit more intelligent. We want to have, if it's greater than, we want to have this here, clipboard counts plus cura files. This is what we want to have instead of find base names thing. We want to put this in here. So let me maybe do it a bit differently, just like for the sake of it, making it a bit more readable. Create a var, how should we call it, paste.txt. Then we put in the QCR paste and the first bracket here as well. Then we check for if the clipboard count is greater than 1. If it's greater than 1, what we will do is just simply paste.txt plus equals, and then we add the we add the clipboard count QCR files, and then this is what we want to do. And else, so if it's not greater than 1, means it's smaller than 1. In this case, if it's 0, it's nothing in the clipboard, it will be not shown anyway. And because we have, this needs to be done as well. The visible here, as you can see here, it's checking if FM source URL is set to something, which is wrong. We have to take a look at the clipboard, if the clipboard is full or not. So this I will do as well. And yeah, else we will do some, so here's the paste, else we do have the find base name, and then this needs to be done elsewhere. So this is our if and else statement, and then after all the if and else statement, we have the paste txt plus equals, we close the bracket simply. Yeah, this is what I want to do, and this is, I think, a thing that should work, if I'm not completely mistaken. Of course, I forgot here, I'm mistaken, paste txt plus equals. And of course, in the end, after building this whole, we have to return paste txt to our text variable here. And yeah, this is one thing that should work now. And what we can do then here in multi-select bar is, we don't need to set the FM source URL. And it should still work. So let's try it out and see if it is working or if I've done some stupid mistake. Of course, there's a stupid mistake by eventually not showing FM Sourceweb at all. Because it's not set. Yeah, it's a stupid mistake to not edit it directly. So what I have to do is simply visible clipboard. Count greater than zero, then it should be there. So let's check if this will work out. It will take a while, I think. There we have it. The paste is not here, as you can see. Let's copy this. It says paste two files, which is wrong. Why does it say paste two files? That doesn't make any sense. Let's select copy. Now it says paste three files. That's interesting. I wonder why this is showing it like this. That's interesting. I don't know why it's showing it like this. Clipboard should be empty. Think I have to go into here and then add a debug output, just see if this is called numerous times or not. This looks a bit weird right now. Yeah, this is not what I was expecting. So now let's see what will happen. So clipboard is empty. If I go now onto and hit copy, you can see that it's adding to clipboard the doc free text two times for some reason. It's adding it two times, and I'm not sure why. So this is something I need to check. Why is it adding this two times to the clipboard? So for this I have to go to file and delegate, and I have to check the copy function. Okay, the copy function has the FM source URL and sets it to clipboard get zero source. This I think is not necessary. Same goes for the move. Or is it? I think maybe it is necessary. Because we want, of course, to get the name of the. Maybe it's not necessary. I did something wrong again. Let's remove it for now, because what we could do is of course also set the the name and paste without using this, but just using the our clipboard. Clipboard get zero source. Not even this, we can even use the name here, yeah? Because when we add something to our clipboard, we already have a name here. So we have a name that we add stuff to. Let's check my file to delegate. Yeah, we have the file name here already. So I don't need to set is it saved as name? Yeah, it's saved as name. So I don't need to find the base name even. I can just set it to the first entry of our clipboard, which is zero. Count is if it's higher than one. Will show. I'm still not sure why it's adding this two times. Let's do it again. Otherwise, I need to check where in OpenDialog and file item delegate clipboard add is located. Let me do this just for the sake of it. So it's for the copy and the move function. Ah, and for checked as well, but I'm not. It's not active anyway. It's not visible. Has the switch also an enabled function? Let's maybe see here. Yes. Let's set it to visible. So disable this just to be sure. I'm not sure what's going wrong here. Copy, and it's showing it's adding it again two times to the clipboard, which is weird. So let's with this check, with the enabled and disabled check if this will work out or not. Usually if it's not visible it should not be affected, but for some reason it is. And the reason is no, why is it so? Do we have any other clipboard add? No, if here clipboard add, we've got here clipboard add, and here. It's checked or not checked. So now clipboard is empty. Now we have two times, for some reason. It's adding it two times. I have an error message here. Cannot read property name of undefined. Yeah. This makes sense because, but why is it even trying to? Because it's else. Okay, the clipboard count is zero or something like this. Should not be visible. So, what I have to do here is basically else if. Clipboard count. Equals one, then it shows this one only. Yeah, this is I think a better solution. So we get rid of this error message, but still, why is it adding the stuff twice to the clipboard? This is what I don't get right now. Because if I press copy here, mm-hmm. see if it is console debug here. Copying file path. I'm gonna do the same debug here for this one and just call it moving. And yeah. Now let's see what will happen. Yeah. So sometimes you can see it will take a while to figure out the stuff. And this is, I think, the last thing that I will figure out. After this, I can release. I'm pretty sure I can release then FileCat. Sometimes you think everything is right and it's not, as you can see here. It's easy to fix and it is not. So, copy. That's interesting. So the function copy is only executed once. But the adding to clipboard is executed twice. Now the question is, why is that happening? That's really, really an interesting thing. Let's go into select mode. Ah! Aha! So now let's go to select mode and you can see that doc1 is selected. Now as doc1 is selected, the reason is, why is it selected? And I think I have the answer. The answer is in our little function that we added that is checking if the clipboard contains the file path, then we should mark automatically the item as checked or unchecked, and this is why it is adding it two times. So what does this mean? This means we have to find a different solution for this. Which is interesting. What we could do, of course, is the add function needs to be, could be cleaner. I don't want to lose this capability. I just think the easiest way here would be having the add function, because it's just appending stuff. And what I want to, so adding something to the clipboard, what I want to do is only add something to the clipboard if the source is not already there. So what I will do is simply say contains path, yeah, return and ask it here, and then make it like this. Let's return false in this case, maybe. Why is it complaining? Why do I want to do it like this? Let's do it differently. Let's do it like this, which is, I think, also understandable and easier even to understand. So what I will do here, as you can see here, is have I will make this add function more intelligent by checking if the path is not already in the clipboard, and only if it isn't already in the clipboard it will append it to the clipboard, otherwise it will not append it to the clipboard. And yeah, if I'm not completely mistaken, this should now... I said this I think half an hour ago already, didn't I? But who is watching so far anyway? And I will not cut this video because this is also a very interesting lesson for people who have enough time to watch it, and first and second of all, to see how poor my programming skills are. No, how even such obvious things can slip through. So let's go here, copy. It is adding it two times probably, but it says now paste doc one text. Okay. And if I do this here and say copy here, what you can see here, we have now two files in the copy in our clipboard. And now if I want to get rid of this, I go into select mode, deselect this one file, click exit, and now it's deselected everything from our clipboard. Select. Okay, I have one file selected. Of course, I need to choose copy. And now I have doc one text, okay. Go to select mode, choose the second one, choose copy. I have two files in here. Go here, choose copy, and go back. Now let's create a new. Now see, we have three files in here. And yeah, so this works. The question is now, is this the way it should work? Like selecting copy here, should it add to the clipboard stuff? And then later I can paste multiple stuff in, or should I have the multi-select appear? So multi-select. I deselected those two. Now it's completely clear, and this one is not in the list at all anymore, which is interesting. Oh, this. I think the copy function itself, when I execute the copy function here and say copy here, it should not add to the clipboard, because this might get confusing for some people who don't want to copy stuff, especially if you don't have the option to put something from the list. Just like, for example, oh, I see I have the other document, I don't want to have this selected, I can select deselect it here, and then you can see only doc one text is in here. And if I click the X here, you can see that the paste is gone already, because it will, if I click the X there, it will now clear automatically the clipboard. So let's not do it like this, like copy and then copy, and we have both in our clipboard. Should we do it? Should we allow it? Should we allow it? And this is, I think, a good question. And with this question, I will go to my file manager and see what my file manager does when I do it. So I have this, I click on copy. I have this, I click on copy. What do I have now in my clipboard? I can show you this. I have one file here, so it's overwriting the other file. So this is basically what I want to do here as well. So to do this, of course, I have to edit the copy function again, file edit delegate. And I have to make sure that whenever I copy or move something, I want to move something, that the clipboard is clear. So the first thing here should be clipboard clear. And this is the same thing I want to have for moving files as well. So I want to clear the clipboard. Now, one thing that I want to do here as well is you saw that when you press in the multi-select bar, you press the X button, the cancel button, what it will do is not only set the select to false, it will also have the clipboard, it will set the clipboard to clear. Now the question is this really what you want to do? Or isn't the thing that you want to do? Because I noticed that sometimes I, by mistake, open up the multi-select clipboard. And what it will do, let me first of all compile this and put it in here. What it will do, or what you need to do is then, if you want to close the multi-select option, the multi-select bar, is click on one of the cut or copy options instead of clicking on the X option, because the X option will clear the clipboard. Yeah, but we have an option now to clear the clipboard if you like to. Several options indeed for clearing the clipboard without seeing its contents. First of all, is if I go here and go into select mode and select those here and say copy, those are now selected. And if I say okay, I want to copy this as well, I have to go into select mode, say copy. And now I see three files to copy, but what if I only want to have two files to copy? I don't want to copy doc3 text. I can go into select mode. And what do I have to do now? I've unselected it now. If I click on X right now, it will remove all the stuff from the clipboard. If I click on copy right now, and now only two files should be copied. And this is, the question is it clear for people or isn't it clear? So I'm not so sure. Sometimes I'm want to click on the X button just to close the multi-select bar, but it's not clear to me that this will remove all the stuff that I have in my clipboard. So the same thing is if I only want to deselect this here, remove it from my clipboard, I have to now to get rid of this multi clipboard thingy, not press X, otherwise everything will be dropped from the clipboard. I have to click on copy because this is the last thing that I want to do, the operation I want to do, and then click on documents, and doc2 should be still in the buffer. So if I go here and say paste, I can now copy doc2 in here, and it really has copied it, as you can see. Complicated, isn't it? Complicated stuff. Now the question is this ready for prime time or isn't it? I think with this video it should be ready. Otherwise, I will make a video that explains the multi-select bar copy and paste stuff again. I think I will do it so people have something to watch as well. And yeah, I will explain several different scenarios on how to copy stuff in the application. So I think, but now we have reached a point where I can say, okay, this is something I can live with. This is a state where I can say clearly, okay, this is what I can really live with. And as you can see here, it works without any problems. So this is a state I can live it. Now it's the now we come to the point of this video, of this whole video, creating a release. Now I have basically the RPM here on my virtual machine. What I need to do for creating the release, of course, is bumping the spec file. I go into here RPM and go into, I can edit the general file, but I will usually edit the spec file. And the last release that I did for the file manager FileCat was 1.1. And this, in my glorious wisdom, I will call this version 1.8, because the multi-select bar feature is a big one. It's maybe not completely there to call it version 2.0. If I would have much more confidence than I have right now, I would just call it 2.0 and say, yep, it's a newly improved, better version of FileCat. But this, I think, is version 1.8. This you can do like you want to do, but what? I will call it 1.8. What you can do, of course, what other people do is just simply what you can also do here is, first of all, let's git diff this whole thing, and I have to commit all this stuff as well here, and I have to remove the debugging output as well, and I need to find a commit message for all this stuff here. So yeah, git dev. So what did I do? I bigger commit now. Fix. Files in clipboard and removing them, plus marking files in clipboard. This is the commit, and I will push it. And then what I see people do sometimes, or what people can do if you'd like to do it, is just counting from version 1.1 all the features that you did. Okay, features that you did really add to the application, then you just increment this 0.1 version. So not putting in the string adjustments for translations, which isn't a feature, I would say. First, work on multi-select and adding files to clipboard. Okay, this is not really something I did. Six, multi-select adding files folders to clipboard. So here we have 1.2, 1.3, 1.4, 1.5, 1.6, 1.7, 1.8. This is how you could count it. 1.9 and 2.0. So it should be in theory 2.0. But yeah, what I will count is not here this, because it's first work, and then I will count it from here at multi-select bar, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. And maybe this doesn't matter. This is how you can also do it if you like to do it. Why do I have it open? Because I need it right next. For another thing that I can do is I can put in changes. As you can see here, I have a change log, and I can put changes in here, and these can be automatically be read by the software when I put it on open repos, for example, or other applications, and they will put it then in the catalog. But I'm lazy when it comes to this. As you can see, it's 1.0. I'm not using the changes. First of all, because I'm not sure if the Yola Harbor is able to do to handle this. I don't think it has such an option, so I do it manually anyway. So the next thing is, of course, I committed stuff already. Did I? Didn't I? I forgot to remove the I forgot to remove the debugging statements and so on. So what I will do right now is here, go in here, search for debug, or search for .log, and there you can see we have some log output that we don't want to maybe show all the time. Just like those functions that are working anyway. Deleting. This might be interesting. We can keep this if an error appears, especially in these early versions, then yeah, might be useful. This does not need to have to be in the logs. Then the next file, search for logs, search for debug, Yeah, I'm using debug. See, we don't need those things. We don't need them any at all. This debugging thing. Temporary. We don't have anything else here. Now let's go to the next one. This we had already. Do we have some debug output here? No. Open dialog. Here we have debug output. Comment it out. This is a normal error message that should be printed on the console if something goes wrong. So this is okay. 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 Do we have a dot log somewhere? We don't have dot log. So this is what I usually do as well. And then let's see. Yeah. Disable some debug output because it's nothing is because if you put too much debug, it's especially internal debug that you only used for debugging certain things, then it's not useful for the user. There are some things just like if moving or copying of the file failed, then it's something I also want to show not only in the graphic user interface but also in the terminal for the user if it executes as a, in the terminal to get perhaps a bit more of an information what's going on. Or at least this is what people are used to. And this is also what I will do then in this case. So I have an i486 version. I bumped the spec file, so I will click on build right now, and what it will do is we'll build this RPM and then execute it for the terminal. And what you will also see is, if you go into here and search for FileCat, you can see the i48, and this is empty right now because it's building right now the version 1.8. And as you can see here, here's Harbor FileCat version 1.8. And what I will do, usually what I do is copy this and paste it in here. It's on a Dropbox, so I don't lose it. Yeah, now I have the i486 version here, and I will do the same with the ARM version. First of all, I test, yeah, it's still working. So the version change and debug output change did not break anything. And then I will go here and build the whole stuff for ARM v7HL. Let's go to the folder here, ARM v7HL, and let's go here, search for FileCat, there we have it, RPMs, waiting for the RPM to build, and this should happen in a few seconds. There we go, copy again, don't copy the debug info or the debug source, just the release. And now I have the refi here as well, and then let's go back to this, and yeah, it's executing it. Checking it on my phone again, also important, not only check on the virtual machine, also check on your phone if it's running or not, and it seems to work. Let's try to copy some log files. Copy them to my documents folder, paste two files, file operation succeeded, and yeah, those two files are in here now. Now let's select them and remove them. File deletion succeeded, and the original files are still there. Okay, everything's working. You didn't see anything right now, so it's a bit boring, but yeah, this is what I usually do. Then when I'm ready with this, I can go on to open repos. I have my website open here of the FileCat application. You can see last version was 1.1 with some changes here, and what I do now is edit here. And then In feature, I will add, of course, yeah, in the text itself, because I added a big new feature is just add it here. Cut, copy and paste multiple files. And yeah, screenshots are fine enough, I think. Could add some new screenshots if I'd like to. But yeah, then the changelog, I will manually edit the changelog and by selecting the commit messages and stuff that I want to. So the work that I did not do for creating the changelog inside of the RPM is what I will do right here. Otherwise, I could click the changelog auto update. And what I will do right now is just selecting the files. You saw that I updated video player today. Filecat, I will upload this. Click on upload. And of course, a tablet version as well, or an i486 version. And then up to the changelog. And what I will do usually is go here, see my git log. And find adjust icon I had. Of course, I need to know. Best is to view the last changelog to see what the latest changes were. Otherwise, you can make a bump in the version all the time when you do new changes. And yeah, the Swedish translation was updated, Italian translation was updated. Updated Swedish and Italian translation, Swedish and Italian translation. The next thing is add multi-select bar, and of course people will say what, and I will say copying of multi-files, cut, copy and remove multiple files. Maybe not allows, but just cut, copy and remove multiple files. This is the biggest new feature, I think. And add error handling to remove and revamp blah blah blah. This I will add here as well. This is also did. Fix overloading file details in multi-select mode. Also something people like to see, that you're also working on the fine details, so don't skip all the fine stuff as well. I said don't need to because I did not have the multi-select bar. And yeah, disable some debug output. I can edit here, I'm not sure if I disabled enough or not. So this is a big new update, and the only thing that I need to do right now is, if everything's alright, is hit the save button. And then a few seconds later, it will be queued for import and will be updating. What I will do now is also copy this changelog, because Filecat is not only living in open repos, it's also living in Harbor. So what I will do, so Yola, the Yola store, is go to harboryola.com. And I will sign in here with my credentials, and as you can see here, I have several apps, and if I want to update an app, I go to your apps, and then I can go to Filecat. And yeah, what I will do here is remove the old files, 1.1 version and 1.8 version. Of course, before I do this, usually if you want to upload something to Harbor, what you need to do is go into Selfish OS and SDK, choose the file. In this case, my Filecat, one of the files, doesn't matter which one. And I want to validate the RPM, so it's going through the validation process of things that the Yola sailors are also doing before approving an application for the harbor. And as you can see, it's passed everything. I was pretty sure it will pass everything, so that's not a problem. But this is, if you write a new app, this is the way to go. And then of course I will upload those apps, this RPM, and then also the other RPM. And yeah, now this is ready. Here are the recent changes. I can enter the stuff here that I had from a changelog. I copied over. This is what I mean by I have to copy this anyway. If I put it, it doesn't make sense to put it in the changelog file if it's not directly put in here. So maybe Yola can fix this somehow. So I don't need to do stuff here. Cut, copy, and paste. Files, edit here as well, and yeah, that's it. I just device type, phone and tablet, and yeah, that's it. Could add an website or YouTube URL or cover image if I like to do it, but nope. This is it for it. And now submit it for a Q&A quality assurance, and they will check it. And you can see here, Invic, your app was submitted. And you have to wait now a few hours, a few days maybe, depending on how much traffic is going on. And they will then commit it if everything's right. Otherwise, they will contact you and write to you what's not working. So hopefully I did everything right now. And I showed you in a very long video how my release process works and how our usual release process works. Of course, I was working on debugging stuff a little bit longer than I would have expected, but now I think I'm coming to a point where I would say Filecat is so advanced that yeah, it needs a bit more testing, and the issues that appear are a bit more complex to solve. And you can see it from the first videos that were, I think, simple videos to this version now. So for the future, what I told you already, there's no direct way to edit stuff in Filecat to edit the clipboard in a graphical manner. So you have a list and you can remove stuff. It's a bit of a manual labor to remove stuff, but everything is in there. Every feature is in there, and I will show people in a small video as well how Filecat will work, how the new feature will work. But yeah, this is everything for this little dev podcast, and now on to creating an app podcast for Filecat and its new feature to move, copy and delete multiple files. So this is everything for this little video. Hope you enjoyed it, and give it a thumbs up, like the video, comment the video, and I'd like to see a comment of the first guy who watched this, the whole video, without skipping through parts. Thanks for watching, and until the next time. Bye.